Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mad at the World, A Life of John Steinbeck, by William Souder, narrated by David Colacci. Humanity is the mold to break away from, the crust to break through, the coal to break into fire, the atom to be split. Robinson Jeffers. Part 1. Between the Mountains and by the Sea. 1. The Boy No One Knew. In the California winter, after the sun is down and the land has gone dark, the cool air slips down the mountainsides that flank the great central valley, settling over the fields and tules below. When conditions are right, the night air forms a fog so dense that you cannot see your own feet on the ground. These fogs can last for days, and sometimes fill all 450 miles of the valley. To the west of the Gabilan Mountains, in Monterey County near the ocean, lies another smaller valley. Once it was an arm of the sea. 90 miles long and shaped like a sword, it follows the course of the Salinas River, which runs north to Monterey Bay. The valley is flat between the Gabilans and the Santa Lucia Mountains that separate it from the Pacific. Here a different fog comes in summer, when inland heating draws in a marine layer of cooler, moist air from the ocean. This seaborne fog does not lie still on the land, but seeps over the folded hillsides, rising and falling along the river bottom. When the fog comes and the mountains are hidden, the world is an abstraction, and you are alone with your thoughts. But the gray veil lifts, the light returns, the scene changes, and the fog retreats. Day by day, the mountains turn from blue-black at dawn to pale gold under the sun and the towering sky, and the earth of the valley floor is lined with rows of lettuce, some a mile long. In the winter of 1902, in the midst of a drought, the skies over the Salinas Valley opened. On February 27th, the Salinas Daily Index reported that the Salinas River, which in the dry season ran underground in places, was out of its channel. Trees along the banks had water 6 feet up their trunks. A tangle of deadfall and debris had swept through the valley overnight in the flood, and those who had been praying for rain began praying for it to stop. That same day, in a large Queen Anne-style house in a well-to-do neighborhood of the town of Salinas, Olive Steinbeck gave birth to her third child and only boy. They named him John, like his father, like his father's father. One world was ending, another beginning. The promise of the new century was that nothing would remain the same for long, including America's place in the world. With the Victorian age barely over, the Steinbeck's baby boy hurtled into a future he would help to write. Before his second birthday, Wilbur and Orville Wright would fly, and within months of his death, Neil Armstrong would walk on the moon. In between, John Steinbeck tried to tell the story every writer hopes to get right, which is only how it was during one small chapter of history. It is not much to ask, but the hardest thing on earth to do. Thousands of years before John Steinbeck opened his eyes, bands of nomadic Indians, most recently the Ohlone, ranged through the Salinas Valley. They lived on game, fish, and shellfish, plus plants and seeds gathered in the woods and on grasslands sustained by controlled burnings that kept down the brush. The Ohlone also raised tobacco and managed a fraught coexistence with rattlers, mountain lions, and the now extinct California grizzly bear. In 1602, a Spanish explorer, Sebastian Vizcaino, sailed up the California coast as far as the estuary of the Salinas River. Captivated by the harbor near the river's mouth and by the panorama of mountains and rocky headlands that curled into the Pacific around the northern and southern ends of a great bay, He named the place Monterey. In 1769, a Spanish expedition coming overland from Baja reached the southern tip of the Salinas Valley and found it an unpromising place. The hills, their report read, gradually became lower and, spreading out at the same time, made the canyon wider. At this place, in sight of two low points formed by the hills, it extends for more than 3 leagues. The soil, the report continued, was poor and offered treacherous footing, as it was full of fissures that crossed it in all directions, whitish in color and scant of pasture. It would take more than 2 centuries for Spain to enforce its claim to Monterey Bay and throughout the rest of Alta California, as this region north of Baja was known. The Spanish established religious missions, built presidios, or forts, and connected the settlements with a 600-mile north-south road, El Camino Real. They brought livestock to the Salinas Valley, lean, compact cattle good for hides and tallow, and tried irrigation schemes at several of the missions, damming rivers, excavating canals and reservoirs, and building aqueducts. As poor as the land appeared, water transformed it into a garden of astonishing abundance. Almost anything would grow on it. The Spanish carved out ranchos for grazing and introduced a novel form of bullfighting in which bulls were made to fight bears. After Mexico gained its independence from Spain in 1821, Alta California was loosely administered as a Mexican territory. In 1846, the United States declared war against Mexico. It was the same year that a group of American settlers led by James Reed and George Donner became snowbound in the mountain passes near Truckee in the Sierra Nevadas of Northern California. Nearly half of the Donner Party, as it came to be known, perished. The others survived by eating their dead family members and friends. The tragedy demonstrated the arduousness of the journey at the heart of America's so-called manifest destiny, a call to occupy the country from sea to sea that was encouraged by President James K. Polk's administration. Immigrants from Europe, having crossed an ocean, now undertook the longer voyage across a continent, wresting the land from native peoples on whom they visited new diseases, the destruction of the bison herds, and a ceaseless war of conquest. The extent of the United States reached violently and inexorably westward. In February of 1848, the war with Mexico ended, and in the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, the United States purchased a vast area between Texas and the Pacific Ocean, including Alta California, for a little more than $18 million. A month earlier, gold had been discovered at Sutter's Mill just east of Sacramento. As prospectors poured into California, it raced toward statehood, which was ratified on September 9, 1850, at Colton Hall in Monterey. As the population swelled, ranching and farming in the Salinas Valley boomed. Heavier-bodied beef cattle arrived from the east. 2 rich aquifers were discovered beneath the valley floor, one at a depth of 180 feet, the other down at 400 feet. Below that is more water, though no one knows how much. By the late 1800s, farmers were experimenting with deep wells and then with pumps powered by gasoline engines. At the turn of the century, 7,000 acres were irrigated. Grains, hay, alfalfa, beans, potatoes, and mustard seed, staples of so-called dry farming, made room for an explosion of new crops, including strawberries and lettuce and sugar beets, as irrigation spread across the valley. Beef, milk, and produce moved out of the valley to San Francisco on the Southern Pacific Railroad, which reached Salinas in 1872. Salinas sat in the midst of 5 large ranchos, residue of the early Spanish licenses, and later the many more Mexican land grants that by Steinbeck's time had been mostly broken up. A provision in the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo promised to keep the ranchos intact and their owners in place. But 3 years later, the California Land Act of 1851 effectively erased many of those long-standing claims. Then, in the 1860s, periods of flooding alternating with drought devastated cattle herds, and over time the rancho owners fell into a downward spiral of debt and rising costs that made their huge holdings, some of the ranchos were nearly 9,000 acres, unsustainable. The ranchos failed, but their boundaries, which wandered along recognizable natural features such as rivers and mountain ranges, kept their identities alive informally. If you said you were from Llano de Buena Vista, anyone would understand that your people lived in the country south of Salinas. Crumbling adobes still stood in places, organic extensions of the earth from which the Spanish and Mexicans had raised them. Most people in Salinas could remember when and how their families had come to the valley. And although Salinas was dominated by its founding families, no one, apart from descendants of the native Ohlone, could claim to have been there first. The ranchos were framed by the mountains, and Salinas was framed by the ranchos, so that the town felt like an island. Salinas had sprung up to the southwest of an imposing, pyramid-shaped mountain called Fremont Peak. The town occupied an 80-acre tract nearly encircled by a sharp bend in a tule-choked waterway called the Alisal Slough, which passed through fields of mustard plants as tall as a man. In the early days, the slough serpentined through the town, though it was interrupted by so many footbridges and streets that it had become a scattering of sloughs without names. Salinas began as a stopping-off place for a stagecoach line, with a hotel and a saloon where patrons could wager on what time the next coach would arrive. The line's most celebrated and heavily bet-on driver was Charlie Parkhurst. After Charlie died in 1879, it came as a shock to everyone when they learned that he was a woman named Charlotte Parkhurst. As a boy, John Ernst Steinbeck Jr. was not lonely, but he was mostly alone. Though he grew up with a handful of schoolmates who liked spending time with him, none felt they knew him well. As one childhood acquaintance put it, John didn't have a lot of friends, but he could be friendly if he liked you. Remote and seemingly preoccupied by ideas he never shared, John was big-boned and rangy, with a blunt face and a thick mop of hair parted on the side. People said he looked like an unmade bed, though his sapphire blue eyes were striking, and he had a piercing gaze that set him apart even more. Until high school, John wore knee pants. Nobody else did. In one important way, though, he was not alone. His older sisters, Esther and Beth, adored John and spoiled him when they were around. But it was his sister Mary from whom he was nearly inseparable. A bold little girl 3 years younger, she was pretty and had blonde, ringleted hair. Mary went where John went, and yet John remained a boy apart in a place unto itself, a small town disconnected from the larger world. From an early age he bridled at the bland striving in this narrow universe, and later on, at the town's conventional propriety, which he came to see as a veneer concealing the darker human impulses that exist everywhere. John's father, John Ernst, had been born in Florida during the Civil War, one of six sons of Johann Adolf Grossteinbeck, a German-born immigrant who shortened his name to Steinbeck on arriving in the United States. Johann Adolf brought his family to California, where they farmed a small acreage near the town of Hollister, north of Salinas. John Ernst studied accounting. Like so many polite and proper men, he was by nature unhappy and spent much of his life wishing he had done something else, without any firm idea of what that would have been. Though he was a passionate gardener, and at one low point said he wished he'd become a farmer. Instead, he went to work for the Southern Pacific Milling Company in King City, at the southern end of the Salinas Valley, and later at Paso Robles, 50 miles to the south in San Luis Obispo County. In King City, he met and married Olive Hamilton, one of Samuel Hamilton's 9 children. Sam Hamilton had lived in Salinas and signed the city charter in 1872 before homesteading a ranch near King City, in a ravine warped into the dry, hard-looking hills, as one friend put it. Hamilton was as charming and wise as his land was poor. His formidable daughter, Olive, taught school but had higher ambitions, and these seemed to be realized when John Ernst became manager of the Sperry Flour Mill in Salinas, by then a growing town of 2,500. Salinas was the county seat of Monterey County, a vast region that touched Monterey Bay, followed the coast down around Carmel and along Big Sur, and included the Salinas Valley and the surrounding mountain ranges, a county larger by half than the state of Delaware. The Steinbecks settled into Salinas's middle class. They bought a big house on Central Avenue, and they built a vacation cottage on a hillside overlooking Monterey Bay in nearby Pacific Grove. But the Sperry Mill closed in 1911, following a period of decline during which John Ernst's salary had been cut in half. Now, with the plant shuttered, he was out of a job. He told Olive he didn't know what to do next. He complained of feeling dippy and became forgetful. He was, he confided to their daughter Esther, a lost sheep. Olive, who kept up a brave front, she said John Ernst had been fortunate to escape a business that probably should have closed a year earlier, admitted in a letter to Esther that John Ernst was tormented and often woke in the middle of the night and remained up until dawn, a spectral figure pacing the silent house. One worry among many was how to keep Esther, who had enrolled at the University of California, Berkeley, in college. Olive reassured Esther that her father's unemployment would not interrupt her schooling, at least for the current term. Esther, meanwhile, contemplated transferring to Stanford. As the family teetered, John and his little sister, Mary, could not grasp what the trouble was. They had been under the impression that their father owned the mill. John Ernst opened a feed store on Main Street, but after a few years, as horses gave way to automobiles, it too failed. Then he landed work as a bookkeeper at the Spreckles Sugar Plant near Salinas, and the family regained its footing. Klaus Spreckles was a German-born sugar and railroad magnate who, beginning in the 1870s, had acquired large tracts of former ranchos in Northern California. Spreckles paid tenant farmers to grow sugar beets, eventually concentrating his efforts in the Salinas Valley. At first, he shipped the beets by train to processing plants to the north, but in 1898 he put up a new facility, at the time the largest sugar processing plant in the world, just 4 miles south of Salinas. Spreckles built a community of small houses for workers near the plant, and this became the factory town of Spreckles. Much of the Salinas Valley, including the town of Salinas, orbited Spreckles. And now, so did the Steinbeck family. In the early years of the new century, Salinas prospered. Main Street was wide, flanked by shops and restaurants and stables, and soon garages and auto dealerships. Telephone wires ran down both sides of the street, and electric lights dangled above the pavement. There was an opera house in town, and in 1911 Salinas became the home of the annual California Rodeo. There was a roller skating rink that was popular. Every evening at 8 p.m., the fire station rang its bell, signaling curfew for the underaged. Before Prohibition arrived in 1920, bars and saloons stood on nearly every corner. They stayed open until 2 a.m. One, called the Stream, featured a spittoon that was a trough of running water beneath the footrail. Bars were generally for men only, though a few had side rooms where women could be served. There was a Chinatown, its air thick with seductive aromas, and its streets lined with gambling houses, where the clack of dominoes could be heard from out on the sidewalk. Many of the town's leading men patronized the red light district on California Street. John heard stories about the sporting houses from a classmate who delivered newspapers and would sometimes be invited in to sit and talk with Jenny, a well-liked madam who smoked cigars and kept her girls out of sight when young visitors stopped by. Despite the family's reversals, John Ernst saw his job at Spreckles as a leveling off of his stuttering career. The Steinbecks led a comfortable life. In early 1923, with help from friends, John Ernst was appointed Monterey County Treasurer after his predecessor committed suicide. The county offices were an easy walk from the Steinbeck home, and the work suited John Ernst. The job paid $250 a month, and John Ernst worked to keep it. He won election to a full term and was routinely reelected after that, remaining in the job for the rest of his life. It was the secure dead end he had always feared and always longed for. The Steinbeck children and their friends gathered at the Central Avenue house to play in the unfinished attic, which was big enough to roller skate in, or out in the yard behind a white picket fence. John organized a boys' club, Mary was included, that met in the basement, which had a dirt floor. John loved dogs. He owned a terrier named Jigs that could play dead, and later a shaggy mutt named Omar. There would always be a Steinbeck dog. One named Teddy figured in an incident John long regretted. His parents were entertaining friends one evening when they got out some photos of John as a toddler, naked and in his bath. John's humiliation simmered for days. Finally, when John Ernst and Olive were out, he found the pictures and burned them. When he was discovered, John's punishment was that he could not play with or even speak to Teddy for 2 weeks. Remembering this as a young man, Steinbeck told a friend that it had been a terrible time, because it was so hard on Teddy. Ignatius Cooper, who belonged to one of Salinas's few black families, recalled playing marbles with John. He thought John's parents were friendly, but found John himself serious and standoffish. John's childhood friends remembered Mr. Steinbeck as tall, reserved, and well-mannered. He was thin and wore a mustache. He always said something pleasant to John's friends when he met up with them. Olive Steinbeck was nice, too. She seemed in charge of everything, including her husband. Outgoing and alert to the family's place in Salinas society, Olive was 35 when John was born. A joiner, she belonged to the Order of the Eastern Star, an auxiliary of the Masons, in which John Ernst was a member. She was also a founder of the Wanderers, a women's club just 35 strong. They maintained a worldly outlook and met to discuss the cultures of other countries. The Wanderers inducted a new member only after someone died or moved away. One of the older Wanderers, Olive was always careful to sit in the back at meetings so she could doze when the speaker bored her. She was convinced that nobody noticed her nodding off, though everyone did. When the town's first women's bridge club was organized, Olive was there. The Steinbecks attended St. Paul's Episcopal Church, as did many of the town's better families. John sometimes carried the cross into the service. though his friends had the impression that he didn't like church and was distracted during the sermons. A piano stood in the Steinbecks' front parlor, a room that was seldom used. The family and their visitors spent more time in the adjoining living room, which had a fireplace. John's bedroom was upstairs. He rarely showed it to anyone. One friend later recalled that it was austere and had a large dresser against one wall on which John kept a supposedly real human skull. Though where he would have gotten one and why Olive would have tolerated such a thing are unknown. John's friends liked visiting because although Olive was strict, she often served them something fun to eat. She could make donuts on short notice. A friend of John's thought his mother looked like a Gibson girl, with a great big bosom and a cinched-in waist. A girl who got invited to join the Steinbecks for dinner from time to time recalled how lovely it was. The food was wonderful and the conversation lively. Mr. and Mrs. Steinbeck liked to tell jokes that kept things moving. If you went often, you heard the same jokes more than once. The Steinbecks were among a number of Selena's families who owned cottages in Pacific Grove and visited them often throughout the year. A tight grid of narrow streets and wind-sculpted trees, the town clung to the peninsula at the southern end of Monterey Bay. Rising from the water's edge in sloping terraces to a high, forested ridge, Pacific Grove was wedged between the towns of Monterey and Carmel. In the late 1880s, the area was a quiet wilderness of woods and grazing lands, mostly owned by a rancher named David Jacks. Jacks had come to the peninsula in 1849 from Scotland with an unquenchable thirst for land. Eventually, he owned more than 100,000 acres. In 1873, a Methodist minister from the East showed up on doctor's orders to spend time in a moderate climate. Jacks gave the man and his wife a small lot in the pines for a shack, where the minister's health improved so much that he hurried back east and returned with friends looking to settle there too. This small group grew into a larger idea, a Methodist retreat inspired by the training camp for Sunday school teachers at Chautauqua Lake, New York. Jacks sold the congregants land for a campground, which they divided into tiny lots, each barely big enough for a tent. Jack sold more land to the Southern Pacific Railroad. More people came. Eventually, the devout were outnumbered, and Pacific Grove was steadily transformed into a vacation spot and a gathering place for artists and writers who liked the air and water, as well as the more colorful diversions around Cannery Row, next door in Monterey. Every fall, clouds of migrating monarch butterflies descended on Pacific Grove to spend the winter there, and each night in all seasons, the beam from the Point Pinos lighthouse bore seaward through the gloom, marking the western edge of the continent. Pacific Grove was 15 miles from Salinas, out at the end of the old road that ran west from Main Street and skirted the Santa Lucias before heading to the ocean. The Steinbeck cottage, small and square, was on a corner of 11th Street in the heart of town. John Ernst kept a garden there, and John inherited his father's passion for growing things. The cottage was just blocks from Lover's Point, a pretty seaside park with a sandy beach for swimming and picnicking, protected from the long Pacific swell that crashed in a tempest of foam and spray against the rocks farther out on the peninsula. Even away from the water, the ocean's presence was carried up the hill on the cries of gulls and the barking of sea lions. John loved his home in the Salinas Valley, loved living surrounded by mountains that felt like family. The gabbelins, he thought, were friendly and inviting, and made you want to climb onto their shoulders, while the Santa Lucias were foreboding, and so in their way foreign, like another country. He wasn't sure why this was so, but thought maybe it was because the sun rose behind the gabbelins, warming and reanimating the world, and went down beyond the Santa Lucias, leaving them in the dark. And he was afraid of the dark. In the light of day, the richness of the broad valley was dazzling, especially after a wet spell when a profusion of grasses and wildflowers burst from the soil. One time John's father helped drill a well. It may have been down at the Hamilton Ranch, and they inspected the changing layers of black dirt, white sand, and coarse gravel that came up as the drill went deeper. There were shells and even a whalebone in a layer of sand from an ancient beach. Farther down, they found a hunk of redwood left by a forest that had been there before the ocean. Sometimes at night, in his room, John thought he could feel an echo of the past through the bones of the big house, as if there were nothing but invisible time between his body and the ancient geological layers of sea and forest below. But he loved Pacific Grove, too, a haven by the water that was so close to the valley and yet a million miles away. This was his life, a good one, a life between the mountains and by the sea. Though he generally preferred his own company, from time to time John assumed the role of leader among a small group of friends. One of the chosen was a neighbor just across Central Avenue from the Steinbecks, a boy named Glenn Graves. The Graves property was big enough for them to keep horses and a chicken coop, a not uncommon practice in Salinas that was sometimes called a farm in town. In the spring of 1906, when John was 4 years old, the chimney on the Graves home toppled during the catastrophic earthquake that hit San Francisco and damaged more than a dozen buildings in Salinas. John came to see himself as a big brother to Glenn, a shy boy who got picked on. Glenn once told his mother that he hoped to grow up to be vice president. When she asked him why only vice president, he answered that John would be president. John told a classmate that he played with Glenn because somebody has to take care of him. As an adult, John would say that the one thing he could not bear was another human being oppressed, abused, or taken advantage of by anyone more powerful, especially if the motive was greed. When they were older, John and Glenn owned shotguns and would take Omar out to the Salinas River with them to swim and hunt rabbits. John was a strong swimmer and fearless, but it was a dangerous place, Graves said, as there were patches of quicksand along the banks of the river. They saw a few rattlesnakes, but never shot a rabbit. Another boy John spent time with was Max Wagner. Wagner had been born in Mexico. His family fled during the Mexican Revolution and settled on a farm about 7 miles outside Salinas. Because Spanish was his first language, most of the other kids thought Wagner was Mexican. John met him one day when they were playing at the Graves house. John was delighted when he discovered that Max, who would later enjoy a long career on screen as a bit player in Hollywood, could sing in Spanish. Wagner joined Glenn and John, usually accompanied by Mary, in exploring a nearby section of the slough, pushing their way out to it through the mustard sticks. They built a raft to float around on when there was enough water for it. Other times they would bend the tules flat and build walkways across the marsh. Apparently their parents were unbothered by these activities, except when it rained, and the banks of the slough, Doby, they called it, turned so slick that falling in and being unable to crawl out was a possibility. When the slough dried out, the cattail tops of the tules cracked and burst open, filling the air with their cottony insides that drifted on the wind. Wagner later remembered that he never saw John doing anything with his father, that they respected each other but were distant. John Ernst did not begrudge his son the life he would have liked for himself, a life of possibility in a burgeoning time, but he disliked being reminded of it and kept to himself. According to Max Wagner, John Ernst always seemed to be at the office. Year after year, John Ernst let the demands of his work close over him. Accepting by increments this self-imposed solitary confinement dulled his senses and made his days somber but easier to tolerate. And by staying out of his son's life, John Ernst shaped that life without meaning to. John was like a shadow cast by his father, a black and moody outline. If John inherited anything from his father, it was a milder case of the elder Steinbeck's susceptibility to bleak moods, a ceaseless struggle between contentment and despair that grew more pronounced as he got older. Sometimes the darkness descended on John without warning. More often, it sat inside him, feeding a desire to be left undisturbed that would come to border on obsession. But the family demanded proper appearances, and John was civil, well-behaved, and apart from the usual childhood malfeasances, never rebellious. And he was protective of Mary. Once when they were playing with a barrel in the yard at the Graves' house, Max crawled inside and Mary impulsively jumped in after him. Her skirt caught and was yanked up to her waist. "Hey," John said, his blue eyes blazing, "don't get fresh with my sister." It was the only disagreement he and Max ever had. Around 1906, John Ernst surprised John with a pony. It was ginger-colored, had a white blaze, and, according to Max Wagner, grew to be a little larger than an ordinary pony, though not as big as a horse. John named her Jill. Max owned a pair of gold-colored chaps that he sometimes loaned to John in exchange for a ride. Much later, Wagner would remember those days as exciting and filled with surprises because John was a born storyteller. This more expansive and imaginative side of his personality, which he took pains to hide most of the time, was propelled by visions of faraway lands and ancient times. It was as if there were another person inside John, whom his friends glimpsed only when he was in a mood to pull back the curtain. John loved to hear stories and to make them up, and always had a part for Max to play. John was the ringleader, Wagner said, as he conducted his little troupe on one adventure after another. Sometimes they were pirates, other times knights in armor. But always they were part of some tale that John seemed to invent on the spot. "He was a sharpie," Wagner said, "and he was always the captain." Wagner and Glenn Graves were privy to something only a few other kids knew about. John and Mary shared a secret language. They sometimes spoke to each other in words that sounded like English, but weren't. John often visited his neighbors, Bell and Jenny Williams, who had never married and lived in a big house with a tennis court. According to Glenn Graves, the sisters knew everything there was to know about the early days of Salinas. John was fascinated by all of it. He was a sponge. If you told him a story, he never forgot it. Another childhood friend said John liked talking to a former ranch foreman named Sylvester Carriaga, who lived around the corner from the Steinbecks and whom everyone knew as Joe. Carriaga told Steinbeck stories about Monterey. These might or might not have included information about Flora Woods, Monterey's best-known madam, who ran a brothel near the waterfront called the Lone Star Cafe. Sometimes John got out a small notebook to write down the things Carriaga told him. John's affinity for stories and his gift for piecing them together from his own imagination had not been apparent at first. For a time, he struggled to read and hated books. Words on a page went blank inside John's brain. Learning to read, he later wrote, had been torture. He regarded books as printed demons, the tongs and thumbscrews of outrageous persecution. Then, when he was 9, his Aunt Molly gave John an unusual book. At first, he regarded it grimly. It was The Boy's King Arthur, a simplified version of William Caxton's edition of Sir Thomas Malory's La Morte d'Arthur, more commonly known as La Morte d'Arthur. But John was beguiled by King Arthur and his mythical court. The Caxton edition, which dates from 1485, is a thicket of perplexing words and mystifying syntax, its archaic vocabulary nearly impenetrable to a contemporary reader. John's children's version was easier, though it retained words and ideas that he found strange and magical. Later, he would develop an affinity for dialects, and he never lost his fascination with the sounds of Malory's ancient language and the mythical place from which it sprang. Other great books, as he called works such as the Bible or Paradise Lost, seemed to him to belong to everyone. But John believed that Malory was his alone, a story written in a way only he could understand. "I love the old spelling of the words," Steinbeck later wrote, "and the words no longer used. Perhaps a passionate love of the English language opened to me from this one book." The private language John and his sister Mary spoke was no doubt based on Malory. John liked to ride Jill out into the fields, Mary at his side, pretending to be on an Arthurian quest. John assumed the role of knight, a stoic, chivalrous protector, while Mary served as squire. She was, he would later say, an excellent one. And every summer, when the Steinbecks made their trip to Pacific Grove, John would beg his father to stop off for their lunch at a pretty valley called Corral de Tierra, with its castle rock formation. A high cliff, the fractured and eroded face of Castle Rock, resembles the ramparts of a great fortress. Here John could imagine Uther Pendragon, the King of England, disguised by Merlin's magic, sleeping with his enemy's wife, who was tricked into believing she lay with her husband. The result of this treachery would be a boy child, Arthur, the future king. Such deeds, such words. The Steinbecks sometimes took Jill with them to Pacific Grove. One summer, John organized a trek into the forest with several vacationing friends from Salinas. John was on foot with Mary riding Jill. John provided a lively narration of their progress deep into the looming woods. The only sounds were his own voice and Jill's soft tread on the pine needles. Before long, they were lost and seemed to be going in circles. Everyone except John and Mary was frightened. After some time wandering among the trees, they found their way home. John always believed there was a parallel spirit world, and the forest impressed him as a place inhabited by things unseen. He kept the memory of it. Like the other kids in Salinas, John began his education at what everyone called the baby school, which included first and second grades, and where children, getting used to being with one another away from home, gathered each day to play beneath the drooping arms of a giant weeping willow. After baby school, John went to the West End Grammar School, where he impressed his classmates as a bright but stubborn child. Out on the gravel schoolyard, he would go off by himself. Sometimes he pretended not to know the answer when a teacher asked him a question, which seemed deliberately odd. Unlike Mary, who would write 100 on her assignments before showing them to their parents, John was uninterested in what they thought. John Ernst routinely asked if he'd gotten a licking at school. Somehow, John was allowed to skip a grade. His friends learned that if they stopped over after school to see if John wanted to come out and play, they were usually told he was immersed in homework, though they came to suspect that he was just reading and didn't want to be around anyone. John was a puzzle. Occasionally, he'd ask a few kids over, take them up to the attic, and tell ghost stories. One time, Max Wagner showed up at the door. Something was going on. Max went in, and the veterinarian was there, explaining to John that Jill had died. Recalling this scene 60 years later, Wagner burst into tears. Salinas High School, a turreted two-story red brick colossus built in 1900, was on Alisal Street, only a couple of blocks from the Steinbeck home, and right across the street from the county courthouse where John Ernst worked. The school was known as the Old Brick Pile. Elvina Iverson, a neighbor who came from one of the oldest families in the valley, remembered walking to school with John every day and never figuring him out. "I don't think anyone ever knew him," she said. "He never, ever talked. He was very shy." John proved an indifferent student in high school, though people noticed how well he did in English. One year, the English teacher required a theme every Friday. John looked forward to these assignments, and the teacher often read his aloud to the class. Another girl who knew John, Dorothy Donahue, was convinced John's reticence hid something going on inside that his friends would have found incomprehensible. "He did things by himself," Donahue said. "He was a deep thinker. People thought he was antisocial, but he was really just thinking." John never let on what he was thinking about. John's reading life intensified as a teenager. Besides Mallory, he read The Lives of the 12 Caesars by the Roman historian Suetonius, many of the major English poets, Walt Whitman's Song of Myself, George Bernard Shaw's play Caesar and Cleopatra, and rafts of fiction that spoke to youthful exuberance, such as Treasure Island by Robert Louis Stevenson. And he read classics, Crime and Punishment and Madame Bovary. The Steinbeck house was full of books, and as John's sister Beth recalled, the choice was ours. Some years later, Steinbeck reckoned that the books he immersed himself in as a boy were realer than experience. He didn't remember them as books, but as something that happened to me. Almost everybody in the school attended a weekly dance in a warehouse by the railroad tracks in Chinatown. John never went. He didn't like going to ball games either. If he had a girlfriend, she would have been the only one who knew it, though it was rumored that he and Max Wagner, who was handsome and popular, sometimes sneaked off to visit two girls who lived over on Market Street. In his senior year, a change came over John, and he got involved in school activities he had previously avoided. He became interested in drama, and landed a part in the school production of Mrs. Bumstead Lee. He was associate editor of the yearbook, El Gabilan, and contributed a funny essay describing the school, including the English classroom. English, he wrote, being a kind of highbrow idea of the American language. John was no athlete, but he was big and strong, and gamely ran track and made the basketball team, though he never got into a game. To everyone's astonishment, John was elected president of the senior class. In 1895, the California National Guard had formed a cavalry unit called Troop C, headquartered in Salinas. For the next two decades, they did nothing but train. Then, in 1916, Troop C was called up to join the punitive expedition under the command of General John J. Pershing. President Woodrow Wilson had ordered Pershing into Mexico to pursue and capture the revolutionary Pancho Villa after Villa raided a U.S. Army post in New Mexico, leaving 16 people dead and the garrison in flames. Troop C was mustered and marched down Main Street in Salinas before a waving crowd. Pershing led 10,000 men south, easily defeating Mexican forces. But they couldn't find Villa and withdrew after a few months. One soldier in Pershing's army was a Harvard-educated 32-year-old National Guardsman from New York named William Maxwell Everts Perkins, who spent much of the campaign reading the Iliad. Perkins longed to return to his job as an editor at the publishing house Charles Scribner's Sons in New York, where in the coming decade he would find himself at the epicenter of a revolution in American literature. Troop C came home to Salinas. No one thought they would stay long. 2 years earlier, on June 28, 1914, a 19-year-old student named Gavrilo Princip had assassinated Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and his wife, shooting them dead with a pistol as they passed by in an open car in Sarajevo. The news reached Salinas a day later, and in the coming months the Salinas Daily Index reported on preparations for war in Europe. And what a terrible war it was. World War I, the Great War. Bitterly, hopefully, and in the end wrongly, it was called the War to End All Wars. The United States remained on the sidelines of the war until the spring of 1917. Though half a world away, the fighting in Europe threatened to end a civilization thousands of years in the making. The war's horrors broke history in two, obliterating all notions of the glories of armed conflict. Soldiers cowering in filthy, water-filled trenches succumbed to disease and incessant mortar fire. Tanks and poison gas rolled across devastated fields, and airplanes fought in the smoke-smudged skies. Everything died in the war. Not just men, but ideals such as valor and duty and honor. The human toll was staggering. In one battle that raged for months along the Somme River in France, more than 3 million had fought, with 1 million killed or wounded. Ultimately, some 2 million American soldiers would deploy to Europe under the command of General Pershing. In Salinas, Troop C was mustered again and marched once more down Main Street on its way to war. Although many people in Salinas were, like the Steinbecks, of German descent, the troops received a rousing send-off. Salinas was all for the war. Salinas High School maintained a military training unit called the Cadets. Many of the boys belonged to it, and they expected to join Troop C after graduation and join the fighting in Europe. John was a cadet and wore the high-colored uniform as they conducted marching drills around town. Glenn Graves remembered a day when he and John were in uniform and encountered a regular Army officer. They were thrilled when they saluted and he saluted back. Sometimes the boys went to the gun range to practice marksmanship. The surplus Army-issued rifles had a brutal recoil, and one time Glenn's shoulder hurt so much after a session at the range that he could not get out of bed the next day. In the summers, the cadets were often put to work on local farms, which were short-handed because of the war. They called these work parties bean vacations. One summer, John also did a stint of work at the Spreckles plant, where he was injured when he got a chemical solvent in his eyes. Nearly blinded, John had his eyes heavily bandaged for days and looked disturbingly like a casualty of war. But he recovered, and it came as a relief and a disappointment when the war ended in the fall of 1918, when John was still a senior at Salinas High. The war was the story of stories, but it would be for others to tell. If his classmates felt they got to know John slightly better as their school days came to a close, what he thought remained a mystery. John was good with his hands and would stay after school to work in the woodshop on his own. Nobody had any idea what he'd do with himself. The prediction for him in the El Gavilan yearbook was that he'd be a preacher, an inside joke. Max Wagner, who knew John as well as anyone could, said he read a lot and could quote from books, but never talked about himself unless it was to be seen as different. John just loved to do the opposite of what a normal person would do, Wagner said. Glenn Graves would sometimes wake up in the middle of the night, notice a light on in John's bedroom across the way, and figure he was reading again. John told him that he always kept paper by his bedside in case he wanted to write something down. What was John's story anyway? The opposite of what a normal person would do doesn't explain much. What's clear is that his mind was aflame from an early age, and that certain impulses fell into place and took hold of young John Steinbeck, a boy who would not conform, who could not tolerate a bully, who believed that somewhere within the solitude he craved, there was a world that could be rendered sensible and fair. These tendencies were hard to reconcile and hinted at a difficult but consequential life ahead. One day after school, John invited a boy named Bill Black up to his bedroom. The house was empty, and the steep, narrow stairway creaked as they climbed to the second floor. Black said the room was plain and dim. Dust floated in shafts of light from two small windows. John walked over to the dresser and motioned for Black to come closer. John knelt and slowly pulled open the bottom drawer. It was full of manuscripts. 2. Live, not hope to live. In October of 1919, John Steinbeck boarded the train in Salinas, his family did not own a car until 1931, for the 75-mile trip north to Palo Alto and Stanford University. At 17, Steinbeck was nearly his adult height of 6 feet. The only other person from Salinas headed to Stanford that fall was Bill Black, a standout athlete who had joined the track team as a pole vaulter. Because he'd gotten a D in Latin, Black had to retake the course to get into Stanford. Black planned to study engineering. He had no idea what Steinbeck was going to college for, but he thought Steinbeck wanted to be a writer. Black never forgot that day in the upstairs bedroom on Central Avenue when he'd listened as Steinbeck read one story after another. There must have been at least 50 of them, each one handwritten on white paper. Black thought the stories were grand, packed with action and easy to follow, and that Steinbeck read them in a way that made them even more compelling. They were all about the Salinas Valley. One story that stayed with Black had been about a pony. From his earliest efforts, Steinbeck was ambivalent about his writing. He was quick to insist that it was no good, and even after he became one of the world's most successful authors, he continued to doubt that anyone would want to read whatever he was working on. Steinbeck was indifferent about the stories he wrote in high school. He'd sent some of them around to magazines, but nothing came of it. This was due in part to Steinbeck's refusal to include his return address with the manuscripts, which he always sent out under a pen name. Unnerved at the prospect of any direct contact with a magazine, he instead watched to see if any of his stories appeared. None did. Steinbeck said later he was scared to death, afraid that if an editor contacted him, it would be with a rejection. Or worse, Steinbeck said, an acceptance. This was the way it was to be for Steinbeck, craving success and horrified that it might befall him. Young, shy, uninterested in school, and reluctant to admit to anyone what he hoped to become, Steinbeck was unlikely Stanford material. Opened in 1891, its first student was future U.S. President Herbert Hoover. The university had begun as a monument to Leland Stanford, Jr. The only child of Leland and Jane Stanford, Leland, Jr. had died of typhus at the age of 15. His father, a railroad tycoon and one-term governor of California, believed Leland, Jr. had spoken to him in a dream, telling him to live for humanity. Stanford University was the result. Public sentiment had been against the university at the outset. It was seen as an unwelcome competitor for the nearby University of California at Berkeley, and a waste of millions of dollars, its detractors said, would have been better spent augmenting the endowments of existing schools. But by the time of Steinbeck's arrival, Stanford had a student body of nearly 3,000, with graduate programs and a medical school. Unlike the elite Eastern colleges on which it was modeled, Stanford was not a selective training ground for the privileged. Most Stanford students came from working-class families. Admission was essentially open to anyone. Tuition for California residents was free, though that changed after Steinbeck's arrival. In 1920, attending Stanford would cost $40 a quarter. Stanford occupied nearly 9,000 acres south of San Francisco, near Menlo Park, where Leland Stanford had farmed, kept a vineyard, and raised horses. Stanford students to this day refer to the university as the farm. In Steinbeck's time, the campus was arranged around a Spanish-influenced central quadrangle, red-roofed and flanked by colonnaded arcades. The low-slung buildings and broad lawns lent it a gauzy otherworldliness. Stanford was the warm, egalitarian antithesis of its stony counterparts in the East. Flowers bloomed in February, and on clear days beneath the rapturous Palo Alto sky, it always felt like spring. Steinbeck's first home at Stanford was the men's dormitory, Encina Hall. Inspired by a Swiss resort Leland Stanford had visited, it stood four stories tall, was built of massive limestone blocks, featured long, echoing hallways, and was home to 400 post-adolescent males who'd come from mostly small towns or rural areas. In the early years, it was bedlam. A favorite prank was turning up a room. That is, turning everything in a room upside down while its residents were elsewhere. Freshmen were regularly tubbed, held underwater until their struggles indicated imminent drowning. Explosions of fireworks and the crash of large objects tossed into the stairwells were common occurrences. Less frequent, but more alarming, was the discharge of a pistol. On registration day in October of 1919, a student named George Moores went down to the swimming pool near Encina and saw a big guy doing laps. It was Steinbeck. They started talking. Moores was the same age as Steinbeck. He'd grown up in Los Gatos, only 20 miles away, and entered Stanford at the age of 16. But he had caught the flu during the 1918 pandemic and missed most of his first year. Moores was lucky. The worldwide flu outbreak infected 500 million people, killing about 1 in 10, nearly 5% of the world's population. Now Moores was back. He told Steinbeck he planned to live in Encina Hall. Steinbeck suggested they room together. To Moores, Steinbeck seemed a friendly lug, a country hick. He had a scar on the side of his chest that he said was from surgery to relieve the pleural pneumonia he'd had as a kid. Steinbeck got a little money from his father each month. His mother sent brandied cherries. One night in the dorm, Steinbeck and Moores gave each other tattoos, small hearts carved with India ink and a razor blade just above their left elbows. Steinbeck was nervous about the blood and was so timid with the razor that Morse's tattoo soon faded away. But Steinbeck's got infected and healed into a welt that was still there 45 years later. He said it had a sharp outline under a full moon. Morse said that from the moment he met Steinbeck, it was clear that the only thing he cared about was writing. He balked at taking courses that he didn't think would make him a better writer. Steinbeck was warned about this, but he only took what he wanted to take, said Morse. In a sign of trouble to come, Steinbeck told his friend Glenn Graves that he preferred spending most of his time in the library. Morse and Steinbeck roomed together off and on for 2 years. Steinbeck's comings and goings confused several people who knew him at Stanford, and their later accounts of his college days did not always agree as to what happened and when. Since it was clear to Morse that Steinbeck was struggling and cared nothing about school, he asked Bill Black if perhaps he could help. Black had already tried to persuade Steinbeck to come out for track, thinking it would help him fit in. Now he admitted to Morse that he was at a loss. "We both liked John," he said later, but in the end there didn't seem to be anything they could do for him. In the summer of 1920, Morse and Steinbeck went down to Salinas. Steinbeck's father had a connection in the highway department and had arranged jobs for them on a survey crew laying out the new Highway 1 south of Carmel, along the coast of Big Sur. At the time, there was no road on the coast, just an old Indian trail. "You could only travel there on foot or horseback," Morse said. It was wild, forbidding country, steep, crawling with poison oak, and teeming with rattlesnakes. Despite the stunning views of the Pacific Ocean, often from high above, it was said that Big Sur could drive people insane if they stayed there too long. Then there were the Watchers, solitary, wraith-like figures that, according to backcountry legend, would appear outlined against the sky on a ridgetop and would vanish if approached. Steinbeck admitted he wasn't sure if any of this was true, but allowed that there could still be some Indians roaming the hills. He and Morse carried sidearms, supposedly for rattlers, though they took occasional pot shots at seagulls. They worked only a short time before Steinbeck decided they'd be happier and safer at the Spreckles sugar plant. They stayed at Steinbeck's home. Morse was smitten with Steinbeck's sister Mary. She was pretty and had a figure that made him lightheaded. Steinbeck, he thought, treated her like a daughter. John Ernst asked Morse to look after Steinbeck at Stanford. Morse wrote the Steinbecks often, more often than Steinbeck did. It fell to Morse to talk with Steinbeck's parents when he disappeared one weekend. Nobody knew where he was, and the Steinbecks were concerned. John Ernst came up to Stanford and spoke with the Dean of Men. Eventually, they learned that Steinbeck, convinced he was on the verge of flunking out, had gone to San Francisco and gotten a job as a clerk in a department store. He eventually turned up at Morse's house in Los Gatos, asking if he could stay there. "Mrs. Morse spent several days straightening me out," Steinbeck later recalled. She persuaded him to call his mother. Steinbeck returned home and later went back to Stanford. Steinbeck had managed to make another friend at school, Carlton Sheffield, whom everyone called Duke. They were in two classes together during freshman year, one of which was French. Later, they shared a room in Encina Hall. Sheffield remembered Steinbeck as a large, rather quiet, impressive individual. He received $50 a month from his parents, which Sheffield said put him in the plutocrat class. Steinbeck kept his hair short on the sides. which Sheffield said emphasized his high forehead and prominent ears. When he laughed, everyone noticed the fathomless blue of his eyes. Steinbeck told Sheffield story after story, mostly about his life before Stanford. Some of them might even have been true. There was the one about putting his sister Mary onto Jill and then tying her feet together under the pony's belly so she wouldn't fall off. She fell off anyway and was dragged over the ground while Steinbeck struggled to pull her free. That sounded real enough. One of Steinbeck's more dubious claims was that he'd lost his virginity to a one-legged babysitter. Sheffield thought Steinbeck had a knack for vivid narration. Talking about the day-long buggy rides from Salinas to Pacific Grove, Steinbeck remembered those trips in such detail that Sheffield said he could almost feel the plume of grit rising behind the horse on the dusty way to the sea. According to Sheffield, Steinbeck joined ROTC but quit almost immediately. It was the same when he went out for the freshman football squad, where they tried, unsuccessfully, to find a place for him on the line. Steinbeck had size and strength, but demonstrated no ability. He rode crew a little longer, but he somehow damaged the veins in his legs as he strained at the oar, an injury that affected him throughout his life. Steinbeck didn't like strangers or crowds, was frightened of public speaking, and tended to keep to himself. Sheffield said Steinbeck worked for a time as a waiter at a Chinese cafe in Palo Alto, where a lot of Stanford students ate because a meal there cost 25 cents. After a few weeks, Steinbeck got into an argument with one of the cooks and had to flee the place. He told Sheffield he had barely beaten a meat cleaver out the door. Steinbeck and Sheffield enjoyed boxing with each other, which Sheffield said usually involved him knocking me down, me getting back up, and him knocking me down again. The taller Steinbeck had a reach and power advantage over Sheffield, but it was the speed of the blows that repeatedly put Sheffield on the floor. While Steinbeck easily cuffed him around, Sheffield always had the feeling that he pulled his punches, not really wanting to hurt him. In the spring of 1921, Sheffield went to Steinbeck's room carrying his boxing gloves. George Moores was there alone, reading a note from Steinbeck. It read, "Gone to China," and instructed Moores to send his things back to Salinas. Moores later said he had no recollection of such a note. Whether these conflicting memories related to Steinbeck's escape to San Francisco or to some other temporary disappearance isn't clear. Keeping track of Steinbeck grew harder. As his friends finished school and left, Steinbeck slogged on at intervals, making scant progress toward a degree. Occasionally, Steinbeck made an effort to be more conscientious about school. Early one year, probably 1923, he wrote home to say that he had resisted the temptation to go to San Francisco to celebrate New Year's Eve. In fact, he planned to give up social activities in the new quarter to focus on studying. Surprisingly, he had registered for a debating class. He admitted he was afraid of the subject, that he had never been comfortable standing in front of people, never knew what to do with his hands or whether he might break down. He hoped the class, even if he didn't earn a good grade, would be a valuable experience. But it was a nerve-wracking prospect. He said that every shark in the school is in the class. Steinbeck signed the letter, as he often did then, John, J-A-W-N. Like college students everywhere, Stanford students had a robust and often troubled relationship with alcohol. In the university's early days, students got free samples of wine from the Stanford Vineyard on campus. Oddly, Leland Stanford had promoted the idea of making Palo Alto a dry city, and over time the faculty and staff of the university became advocates for prohibition. This did not slow the steady traffic of students between campus and the nearby towns where they could drink, nor did it prevent alcohol from finding its way to Encina Hall, which, along with the houses on Fraternity Row, was famous for its beer busts. Administrators' attempts to impede campus drinking went nowhere until 1908, when a Stanford student got drunk in Menlo Park and was shot dead after entering the wrong house in Palo Alto, thinking it was where he lived. The state of California responded by outlawing alcohol sales within a mile and a half of the Stanford campus, a move that only made it a slightly longer walk for a beer. But Steinbeck had arrived at Stanford just in time for a great national experiment. In 1919, a congressman from Granite Falls, Minnesota, named Andrew Volstead, wrote the enabling legislation that led to the adoption of the 18th Amendment in 1920. The era of prohibition, which outlawed the production, importation, and sale of intoxicating liquors, had begun, as had the era of ignoring it. Prohibition had scarcely taken effect when people started talking about repealing the amendment, though supporters believed that would never happen. Morris Shepherd, a U.S. senator from Texas who had sponsored the amendment, said, "There is as much chance of repealing the 18th Amendment as there is for a hummingbird to fly to the planet Mars with the Washington Monument tied to its tail." Prohibition was repealed in 1933. While it lasted, people made do. Alcohol consumption declined, but according to estimates, never fell below 60% of pre-prohibition levels. And binge drinking continued to be a regular feature of college life. At Stanford, alcohol was an essential lubricant for many activities: dates, fraternity hazings, house parties, and especially the big game. The big game was the annual football matchup between Stanford and Cal, the University of California, Berkeley, which was played following a week-long series of rallies, bonfires, and parties. The social event of the year, it was one of the few occasions for which Steinbeck could tolerate being part of a crowd. For the 1922 game, Steinbeck arrived in a coat lined with test tubes that were filled with grain alcohol. Sheffield said that Steinbeck went out with a few women from time to time, but never had a steady girlfriend. Late one night, he came back to their room drunk. Earlier in the evening, they'd been drinking Chinese absinthe with Steinbeck's friend Carl Wilhelmsen, a dark and morose Finn who spoke with a heavy accent. Wilhelmsen was a veteran and struggled to conceal nerves that had been badly jangled in battle. The absinthe was a nasty yellowish-green color, and it did not agree with Sheffield, who declined a second shot. He looked on as Steinbeck and Wilhelmsen continued to swallow the stuff. They also smoked a little marijuana that Steinbeck had gotten in Salinas. Eventually, Steinbeck said he had a date and left. Sheffield awoke when Steinbeck returned hours later. He sat down unsteadily on Sheffield's bed, landing partly on Sheffield's chest, and began to cry. Steinbeck said he'd gone out with a wonderful girl and told her what a sad life he had. She answered him by describing what a sad life she had. They'd held each other and sobbed. Now Steinbeck had started up again. After a bit, he composed himself, flopped over onto his own bed, and passed out. The next day, Steinbeck was hungover and skipped his lessons. That evening, Sheffield found him rigid and unresponsive in bed. Alarmed, Sheffield was about to run for a doctor when Steinbeck went slack and took a heavy breath. They decided it had been some sort of seizure and vowed to avoid Chinese absinthe going forward. Whether Steinbeck's life then was sad is debatable. Certainly he was adrift and unhappy, and he wondered, when he dared to think about it, what in the world he was doing in college. Steinbeck wanted only to write and didn't know if Stanford was helping or getting in his way. On several occasions, Steinbeck came into the dorm room and, without saying a word, took out his revolver and fired it into the wall. "It made quite a noise," Sheffield said, "and left big holes in the wall." Steinbeck never explained himself. When he wasn't writing, Steinbeck read. One author he admired was the fantasy writer James Branch Cabell, whose most notable book was Jürgen, A Comedy of Justice, in which a middle-aged pawnbroker makes an inadvertent deal with the devil and is transported to an imaginary realm in which he is young again and burning with desire. Steinbeck also discovered a prolific Irish novelist, short story writer, and poet named Don Byrne, who cranked out book after book. His first novel, published in 1919, was The Stranger's Banquet, which told the story of a first-generation Irish-American woman who inherits her father's shipbuilding business and runs it with an unlikely mix of ambition and fair-mindedness. Byrne had a penchant for archaic syntax and sometimes veered briefly into Gaelic, tendencies that charmed Steinbeck. Sometimes, Sheffield said, Steinbeck would try a course for a week or two and then quit if it didn't suit him. One summer, Steinbeck and Mary, who had also enrolled at Stanford, took classes at the Hopkins Marine Station, Stanford's ocean research facility in Pacific Grove. Steinbeck also made room for some history classes, but he stuck mainly to English courses, often not bothering with final exams. Sheffield said Steinbeck shrugged this off, claiming that he didn't need to prove what he'd gotten from a course, as he was well aware of anything he learned. During his on-again, off-again career at Stanford, Steinbeck managed to earn 95 units, slightly more than half of what was needed to graduate. He completed 14 English classes, earning 3 A's, though his grades in the others ranged as low as a D. In the spring of 1923, Steinbeck and Sheffield enrolled in a poetry writing class, taught by a gray-maned professor named William Herbert Carruth. When the weather was nice, the class met on the lawn in the shade of an oak tree, its leaves casting wavering shadows on the grass as Carruth gently critiqued their efforts. Sheffield said he and Steinbeck often felt stymied and would take long walks looking for inspiration. One of the poems Steinbeck wrote hinted at a lust for life and a corresponding distaste for abstract ideas that would have surprised people who thought him lazy and standoffish. Though written in a self-consciously formal voice, it was good in places, and ended on a note suggesting he wanted to make the most of every minute, and that if he succeeded, then I shall have really lived, not hoped to live. Sheffield graduated in 1923. He went down to Pacific Grove to spend time with Steinbeck. He got in after dark and had trouble finding the little cottage on 11th Street. Steinbeck, who'd arrived a few days earlier, took Sheffield over to Monterey for enchiladas and to pick up a couple gallons of bootleg wine. A few days later, after Mary and a Salinas friend named Phyllis joined them, they went back for more wine. Steinbeck thought the bootleg joint, it was in the kitchen of a hotel in a seedy part of town, was too rough for the women. He asked them to wait in the car and handed Mary his revolver in case anyone tried to bother them. Steinbeck and Sheffield sampled the goods before paying, then returned to the car in what they hoped was a discreet manner, but which looked more like suspicious skulking. Mary mistook them for some other men she'd seen lurking about and warned them she had a gun and to stay back. They managed to identify themselves just before she pulled the trigger. It was a fine vacation. Before Sheffield left, The four of them went dancing and were tossed out of several clubs for twining legs and dancing cheek to cheek, which was considered indecent. That summer, with Sheffield off to a newspaper job in Long Beach, Steinbeck worked again at the sugar plant in Spreckles as a chemist. This involved performing simple tests on the beet juice as it moved to the crystallization vats. One of his other duties was preventing the plant workers from raiding the lab's stock of grain alcohol. Steinbeck always got along well with working men, Sheffield said. He and Steinbeck wrote to each other often, their letters a mix of essays, short stories, and reports of daily life. Sheffield thought enough of Steinbeck's embryonic literary career that he started saving Steinbeck's letters on the chance they'd be important one day. When they looked at them together years later, Steinbeck was appalled at their indelicacy and insisted on burning most of them. Steinbeck never tired of observing his co-workers. There was a group of Filipinos and Mexicans at the plant whom Steinbeck hung out with. They looked up to Steinbeck, who was educated and gave them sound advice on many matters. They taught him how to throw the heavy-bladed knives they used for cutting beets. The following summer, Steinbeck and Sheffield worked at the new Spreckles plant in Manteca, in the San Joaquin Valley, east of San Francisco. The heat was tremendous, well over 100 degrees in the shade. It was hotter inside the plant. They worked 12-hour shifts, 7 days a week. Their plan was to save up enough money to buy an old car and drive down to Mexico. But Steinbeck was restless, and they lasted less than a month. After going to San Francisco for a couple of days, they went down to Los Angeles to stay with Sheffield's family. In the fall of 1923, Steinbeck returned to Stanford. With Sheffield and George Moores gone, he grew close to another aspiring writer he'd met the year before. His name was Webster Toby Street. Street was a veteran who'd lost an eye in the Great War, and he received $100 a month for his disability. He and Steinbeck attended meetings of the English Club, though it was unclear whether Steinbeck was formerly a member. One of the club's advisors was a professor named Marjorie Bailey, a Samuel Johnson scholar who taught a literature survey course that had captivated Steinbeck. Bailey had a house on campus where she put on Sunday afternoon salons to discuss students' work, serve refreshments, and read aloud from books she found interesting. Steinbeck and Street, who thought he might want to become a playwright, were often invited to attend. Steinbeck was attracted to Bailey's intelligence and love of literature. Bailey, for her part, found Steinbeck prickly, and they quarreled often. After one of these explosions, Steinbeck would stay away for a time before going back and starting over. Steinbeck had an intense fling with a young woman he met in English Club. Her name was Catherine Beswick. She was a year ahead of Steinbeck at Stanford and wrote poetry that everybody, including Steinbeck, thought was good. Beswick would eventually see her work published in Poetry magazine. In school, she read Steinbeck's work and made him happy by discussing it with him. In private, they formed a two-person resistance movement to counter Marjorie Bailey's views on sex. She was against it. They were emphatically in favor. Toby Street said that when he and Steinbeck got to know each other, Steinbeck was leading a strange life. He lived in a shed attached to a crumbling stable in Palo Alto, near San Francisquito Creek. A waterway that once teemed with salmon and sea-run trout, it curled through the heart of the farm on its way to San Francisco Bay, and was one of the features that had inspired Leland Stanford to start buying land there back in 1876. Steinbeck's shed was cramped, barely big enough for the cot, table, and chair that were its only furnishings. But Steinbeck had made it comfortable. He'd managed to find rugs for the floor and had hung a few pictures and even a curtain. His typewriter was perched on a wooden box. When he needed a bathroom, he was permitted in the adjacent main house. The finishing touch was a little dog Steinbeck adopted that was devoted to him. Toby Street had the impression that Steinbeck didn't pay anything for use of the shed, and also that he was no longer getting money from home. He lived close to the ground at Stanford, yet seemed not to belong there. At times it was not clear whether Steinbeck was enrolled in school or merely talked his way into a few classes. Steinbeck liked the shed because it was out of the way and quiet, which was conducive to writing. He'd finished several stories, some better than others. One was about a mechanic who curses God when a machine pulls his arm off. When additional misfortunes befall him, the man assumes they are God's punishment for his blasphemy. Steinbeck thought he'd gotten that one about half right. He also liked a story about a nun, and another inspired by a visit he and Wilhelmsen had made to a whorehouse in Salinas, a trip to the seamier side of his hometown that Steinbeck would put to use many years later. As uneven as the stories were, Steinbeck told himself hopefully that they were original. The stories gathered dust in the shed. Steinbeck did manage to publish a couple of pieces during his time at Stanford. Two stories were accepted by the Stanford Spectator, a short live journal published in 1923 and 1924 by the English and Press Clubs. Fingers of Cloud, a satire on college proturvity, featured an orphan, a dim albino girl of 18, who was caught in a storm while walking to a hilltop overlooking a highway near her home. Blinded by the wind and rain, she tumbles down the hill, becomes lost, and eventually finds her way to a ranch and a bunkhouse full of half-drunk Filipino farm workers. Their boss is beguiled by the girl, whose pale skin is a stark contrast to his own. He declares that he will marry her and does. But the man is cruel and soon repulsive to her. She leaves, climbing back to the hilltop overlooking the highway. The story's meaning wasn't clear, and Steinbeck's use of the obscure Latinate proturvity in reference to the girl's allure didn't help, though it suggested Steinbeck thought college taught students to cloak their carnal instincts with fancy words. It may have also indicated that he had come to believe that pretty girls are haunted by trouble, whether unbidden or of their own making. Possibly this sprang from his own experience, or only reflected a tacit misogyny of the times, but it solidified into a conviction he would write about often, and a prejudice he would stumble over again and again in his own often messy life. During his stay on the creek, Steinbeck had an interesting neighbor, a divorced woman with two daughters. Her name was Elizabeth Smith, but she was an aspiring writer and used the pen name John Breck. Toby Street recalled that Breck wrote stories in which animals could speak. Steinbeck thought Breck had technical skill, but that her stories never worked. Breck was among a widening circle of friends, and many of them came by the shed to talk and drink. So Steinbeck didn't think much of it one day when there was a knock at his door. After a few moments and some rustling, a flustered Steinbeck answered. It was Toby Street's future mother-in-law. She was the widow of a Stanford professor named William Whitman Price, who'd built a resort on Fallen Leaf Lake near Lake Tahoe. Mrs. Price lived in Palo Alto and managed the lodge during the season. Street planned to spend the summer there.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.